talking with Jameika Thompson-Hairston. She has written Queen Pin, a memoir, and it's published by Grand Central Books. Welcome, Jameika.
And thank you for having me, Connie.
Thank you. And it's quite a story you tell. And we should tell our friends in the audience, this is after 12 years incarceration.
Yes.
Incarcerated and called Queen Pin of the Drugs.
Yes.
But how did it all start? You were married to a man named Daff?
Yes, I was.
I had a child, Anthony.
Yes, I did.
And the money kept rolling in.
Yes.
And what stopped it?
Was arrested.
Oh, but that's many years later.
Yes.
Because Daff is killed.
Yes.
Then there are a few other men who, which is interesting, you refer to as cities.
Yes.
Who did anyone at any point say to you, Jameika, you could get into trouble here?
No one have never said that to me.
Never?
Never.
In the beginning, it was what, pot?
Yes, it was.
When did the switch come to cocaine?
Shortly after I turned 18 years old.
And yet you yourself, you say in the book, never indulged in it.
No.
How were you so smart not to get yourself hooked?
I just knew that I enjoyed the money more than doing the drug.
Yeah.
So I found my power in selling the drug and making the money.
Yeah. Most of the people like that?
Pretty much.
Yeah.
You don't find too many drug dealers also doing their product.
Yeah. Yeah. So they're smart enough to know, not for me.
Yes. Because this actually became my business.
Yeah. What's interesting is you really had a flamboyant life. I mean, Las Vegas here, Detroit, Chicago, there was always a man someplace.
Yes, it was, Connie.
In Atlanta, even.
Yes.
Yeah. Talk about when you are doing that, being the mother to your son.
Being a drug dealer, I continue to be a mother to my son, and I try to separate my son from the lifestyle that I was living. So I kind of, in a way, sheltered him from, so he wouldn't see anything, because he actually never seen me actually selling the drugs or distributing the drugs, even though the drugs were right up under our roof.
Were you ever afraid that he would get hooked, especially when you were in jail?
At the time that I was selling drugs, I was never afraid that he would get hooked. That was never my concern, because the state of mind that I was in, it was all about what I was doing, what Jameika was doing, just staying in control of, you know, my activity.
But you're warned that the FBI and the government are after you, and you take off. Meanwhile, you have started a hair business.
Yes.
Which is very chic, and you're at the best parties, and Berry Gordy has you in there for his daughter-in-law.
Yes.
Yeah. That was pretty creative.
Now that I look back, I was living a double life, and I didn't even look at it like that then.
Yeah. Finally, you come back for your son's, sixth grade graduation?
Yes.
And there is the FBI saying, we want you and in here. And from there on in, your life is never the same.
No, it's not.
Including a very ghastly trial in Missouri with a very bad lawyer.
Yes.
What could he have done differently?
I think that if he would have, it was other lawyers that was helping him behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And by me being his first main case and federal case, he was kind of going from the DA to the other lawyers and was kind of getting confused from what I observed.
Yeah. And there was a big period between you're judged guilty, but then you don't get the what's going to happen to you for like 6 months.
Yes, you wait for your sentencing. Your sentencing follow months after you've been found guilty.
Really?
Yes.
And you, meanwhile, are in jail?
Yes, I am.
They didn't let you have bail?
No. They denied my bail.
Why?
They said that I was a flight risk because they were looking for me.
Yeah. And during this period, they kept saying, name names. I kept thinking of the communists, the Red Period, name names and you'll get off.
Yes, they wanted me to cooperate with them and give up other people that was in the drug business.
And one person had given you a Cheech?
His name is Cheese.
Yeah. He was a singer, he was all sorts of things, but he was also a frightened man who named names.
And he was also an ex-boyfriend of mine.
Yeah. Now you are sentenced, I guess you could have been sentenced for life.
Yes, I was looking at 25 to life.
Wow. What brought it down to 16?
The judge actually went by the guidelines. And by them reducing a little bit of the counts that were charged against me, he gave me the high end of the guidelines.
Yeah. During the period in jail, you become, I suppose, inspired at the idea of God and Christianity.
Yes, kind of immediately when I was arrested, I knew that it was something that I couldn't get myself out of. So immediately I called out to God and I said, God, if you're really real, get me out of this mess and I will serve you until the day I die.
Yeah.
Because I went to church all my life, but sitting in jail where I couldn't call mother, I couldn't call my father, I couldn't call anyone. The only person that was there that I felt I can call on was God.
Yeah. You had a friend, Tyrene, is that her name, who had already become a minister?
I had my best friend from the third grade, her name was Tanya.
Tanya.
And she had already became a minister.
Yeah.
And she was witnessing to me while I was on the run and even prior before I was incarcerated, but I wasn't listening. I was just so blind to what I was doing. All I seen was the money, the power and the control.
Yeah. And what was that moment when you said, I give myself up?
The moment that I said I give myself up to God was when I was in that cell, isolation, with no one to talk to, no one to turn to. And I can just remember looking up to God and saying, help me, keep me in my right mind. And right